The title of my book is evil, but it is to say, let us forget this category and let us find other categories. And here begins the difficult job for the social science, because all these problems are not so easy to understand. If I can take a very short example, we had recently this awful murdering in Norway, 79 people killed. So some people say, oh, we are sociologists, there are some social factors that can explain because there is a political discourse in the country against Islam or migrants or whatever. But of course nobody can say it's enough. Then other people say, no, it's not sociology, it's psychology. Let us understand the psychology is personal. But of course, it's not enough. So this is why evil, we shall forget it, but we cannot forget it totally as a category. Because there is some mystery in what we try to understand. Why, in the same situation, with the same personality, you will commit a murder, he will commit a murder, and I will not commit a murder. Why? There is something of that kind.
I mean, the problem is, for people like criminologists who start or have recourse to words like evil, is that in a way, I mean, they get in the way of what the problem of the sociology talk about understanding. I mean, you're talking about, you know, the Anders Breivik case. If you start trying to understand it, people in the general population often talk about understanding being almost the same as everything. They accuse you, don't they?
That's right. Very often the concept of evil is used to actually stop the mass transformation. The behaviour is so horrific that you try and stop the explanation by saying that this is simply evil. But that cuts both ways, because one important development in sociology has been that to understand behaviour, you have to express empathy. It becomes very, very difficult to express Verstehen for this type of behaviour. Is this a limit to social science or a particular type of social science? I don't know.
Sure. Oh, it's a very important issue. Because I would defend the opposite perspective. That is to say, the more you explain, the more you can help in order to fight against crime, evil. Because if you say, don't explain, if you try to explain, it means that you're someone who has it. It means that how will you fight something that you don't explain? How do you fight racism, for example, if you don't try to understand why people become racist? You are not born a racist, you become a racist. So if you don't try to understand, to explain, maybe you need some empathy to listen to the people that are racist, to try to understand what they mean. But it does not mean that you don't want to fight against
them. I want to ask this because some time ago on this program, Stephen Pinker was on talking about his book about declines in the amount of violence that one is seeing around the world. In a way, linked to people like Norbert Elias, the idea of really our greater and greater civilization. But I mean, you, in your book, draw attention, don't you, Michel, to many manifestations of forms of violence. I mean, you seem to be suggesting really there are forms of violence now which need new explanations.
Well, there are so many different forms of violence that, from my point of view, it is not serious to say that there is a general trend towards less and less violence. Even if I love North Africa and Israel, of course. So, why do I say that? Let me give an example. One century ago, violence against women did not exist as such, almost, because there was no room to discuss it. It was private. So, if it is private, it's not in the public domain. And violence against children did not exist because it was private. Nowadays, every day in your newspapers, you know that there is more violence. Violence exists. So would you say there is more or less violence against women? No. What you can say for sure is that now it's part of the public debate and that you can fight against it. So, and maybe we don't have these big wars that we had in the 19th century or in the 20th century, but we have all this awful, listen, today, every day, 50 people or 100 people are killed in Syria. So it's not interesting to discuss like this a general trend to what's
happening. But we can say, can't we, that the development of the human rights movement, and the development of notions of restorative justice, in both cases, urge us to pay more attention to particular acts.
No, I completely. I agree with you that as the sociology of evil develops, people to try and ground notions of what evil may be, try, for example, to ground it by building human rights. I understand that. I'm not sure how far ultimately you can go with that type of explanation, but that human rights is not simply a set of laws, it's part of the universal culture. And we must recognise this.
Turning back to what Michelle was saying at the beginning, isn't it? Because if we have a developed concept of the subject, a developed concept of what other human beings are like, then our recognition of when evil occurs, when complete degradation of that person occurs, then we can recognise it more readily. But I mean, in the past, the inclination was to regard other people as somehow less worthy, and therefore the possibility of committing evil against them is somehow reduced by our characterisation of them.
Absolutely right. And there is another dimension, which is the fact that in the past, when we are discussing violence, the crime, and so on, the main problem was not the victim. The main problem was the system, the state, the order. So, if you don't have any interest for the victims, you will not mind in terms of human rights. You will speak of the general order is at stake. Or problem. Nowadays, and this is a very important revolution, nowadays we are more and more interested in the human being when he or she is a victim. And this means that human rights become a very central issue of public life.
Thank you, sir. Michelle, thank you very much for the program. Next week, we have David Harvey on the program. David Harvey, whose book, The Enigma of Capital, I remember was pretty extensively discussed on this program some time ago, and attracted a great deal of attention. He's going to be with me in the studio talking about his new work on how cities might increasingly become the focus for anti-capitalist resistance.
This programme is made in association with the Open University. Thinking Labs, presented by Laurie Taylor and produced by Chain Digital. You can sign up for the programme's download by going to the Radio 4 website. In a moment, the video show asks, well, how well did the BBC company Arab Spring? First, Eddie Mayer has news in the air.
It's not been a glorious week for banks. This time last week, details were emerging from the staff through RBS, which would go on to